Hi everyone! Welcome back to integralcalc.com. Today we're going to be doing another second order differential equations problem. In this one they've asked us to solve the initial value problem that involves this function here and these two initial conditions. So the first thing we're going to need is a couple of formulas. We'll be using the product rule, which is this first formula here, which we should be familiar with at this point. And the second one is this formula here for second order differential equations when we have equal real roots. We're usually either dealing with distinct real roots, equal real roots, or complex conjugate roots, which we'll talk about as well in a second. So the first thing that we do in a problem like this is convert our original function here to an equation involving the variable r instead of the variable y. And here's what that looks like. The way that we're going to do it, I think the easiest way to do it is just a simple trick I use where I count the hash marks on the y variables. So this is y double prime, it's the second derivative of y, but obviously two hash marks right here, right? So we want to replace it with the variable r. Since there's two hash marks, we're going to replace it with r squared. With this variable here, we're looking at y prime, the derivative of y, but most importantly, one hash mark. So we're looking at r to the 1, which of course is just r. So you can see we've put in r squared here, r for y prime. Then for this y variable here, we have zero hash marks. So that's going to be r to the 0. Anything raised to the 0 power is just 1. So instead of putting a variable in here, we're just going to multiply 121 by 1, which obviously will just end up with 121. So that's how we convert from y's to r's. It's a simple trick. It gets the job done. And we end up with this equation here involving r. The reason that we do that is because we're now going to solve this equation for r, and our result will be the roots or solutions of this equation. So when we factor, we get r plus 11 times r plus 11 equals 0, which means that we have two solutions, both of which are negative 11. That means that we have equal real roots, meaning that these are both real numbers and they're equal to one another. They're both negative 11. Sometimes you have distinct real roots where you have two real numbers for your solutions, but they're different from one another. In that case, you use a different formula. When we have equal real roots, we use this formula here. When we have complex conjugate roots, which we'll talk about in the next example, we use a different formula. In this case, we're using this formula here, y of x, and we get this formula. This part here to the right of this equation sign is a simplified version where we factor out e to the r sub 1 x. So what we're going to do is plug in our solution for r to our formula here. And it's going in for r sub 1. See, we have r sub 1 and r sub 1 because our roots are equal to one another. So r sub 1 and r sub 1 are equal to each other. You see, we're plugging in negative 11 to both terms here for r sub 1 each time. Notice that these two terms are exactly the same except that the second one is multiplied by x. And the reason that we do that is because there would be no other way of distinguishing between c sub 1 and c sub 2, these two different terms. It reminds you that we have two solutions here to our equation. So we plug in our roots, negative 11 and negative 11. Now what we're going to need to do is work toward solving for c sub 1 and c sub 2. Once we do, we'll have our final answer. The way that we're going to do it is take the derivative of y of x to get y prime of x. Once we have y of x and y prime of x, we will use our initial conditions here, y of 0 equals 2, which will go into y of x, and y prime of 0 equals negative 25, which will go into y prime of x, and that will give us two equations involving c sub 1 and c sub 2 that we can solve with simultaneous equations for c sub 1, c sub 2, plug those back into this equation here to get our final answer. So now that we have the roadmap, we'll take the derivative of y of x, which is y prime of x. And again, we're going to need the product rule for this part. So for this first term, we don't need the product rule. That's for the second term. For the first term, we're going to be treating c sub 1 and c sub 2 as part of the coefficients on these terms. So they're going to stay right where they are. We can more or less ignore them. Just leave them in there because they're like coefficients on these terms. So remember that the derivative of e to the negative 11x would be negative 11 e to the negative 11x. So you see we've multiplied this negative 11 out in front here, left the c sub 1 where it is, and everything else about this term stays the same. These two terms here come from this second term because we're going to use product rule. So when we use product rule, we will treat our first function, f of x, as c sub 2 times x, and our second function, g of x, as e to the negative 11x. So you can see here, product rule tells us we're taking the derivative of f of x, which we said was c sub 2 times x. The derivative of that is just going to be c sub 2 because c sub 2 is like the coefficient on x. It's the same thing as saying that the derivative of 3x is 3. The derivative of c sub 2 times x is just going to be c sub 2. So there's our derivative right there of f of x. And then we're leaving g of x as it is. So we said g of x was e to the negative 11x, so that stays right there. Now, now we're looking at this part here of our product rule formula, f of x times g prime of x. So remember we said that f of x was c sub 2 of x. We're leaving that alone according to our product rule formula. So that's right here, c sub 2 of x. Then g prime of x, remember g of x is e to the negative 11x, so the derivative of that is negative 11 e to the negative 11x. So the negative 11 part came out in front here, and then we left e to the negative 11x. So that's how we apply product rule to this term. And now what we're going to do is plug in our initial conditions. So we have y of x, and to that we're going to be applying y of 0 equals 2. We also have y prime of x, and to that we're going to be applying y prime of 0 equals negative 25. So for y of x here, we'll plug in 0 for x, which is what our initial condition indicates that we should do, and set it equal to 2. So we plug in 0 for x, and we plug in 0 here, here, and here, and set the whole equation equal to 2. So simplifying this will give us c sub 1 times 1 equals 2. E to the 0, this is going to end up being e to the 0. Remember, anything raised to the 0 power is 1. So we end up with c sub 1 times 1. This whole second term disappears because we've got it multiplied by 0. So that equals 2, which obviously means that c sub 1 is equal to 2. So we'll hold on to that for a second, and now we'll start working with y prime of x. And that's not just hanging out there. We'll use it later. So now y prime of x, we had that y prime of x formula. We're going to plug in 0 for x and set it equal to 25. So you can see we've plugged in 0 for x here, set this equal to 25. And when we simplify, remembering that that e to the 0 is 1, we get negative 11 c sub 1 times 1. This term here, we get c sub 2 times 1 because this e to the 0 is 1. This whole third term disappears because it's multiplied by 0, and it's equal to negative 25. When we simplify that, we'll get negative 11 c sub 1 plus c sub 2 equals negative 25. Now remember, from our previous equation, we found that c sub 1 was equal to 2. So if we plug that in to this last equation here for c sub 1, you can see we have negative 11 times 2. And when we simplify this, we'll get negative 22 plus c sub 2 equals negative 25. Adding 22 to both sides will get us c sub 2 by itself, and we'll get c sub 2 equals negative 3. So remember, that was our whole goal, to solve for c sub 1 and c sub 2. And now that we've done that, we can plug it back into our original equation for y of x that we found. C sub 1 equals 2 goes in here for c sub 1, and negative 3 goes in here for c sub 2. So we could leave this exactly as it is, and it would be perfectly correct, or we can choose to factor out e to the negative 11x, and we'll get e to the negative 11x times 2 minus 3x, which is also a clean way of writing our final answer. So I hope that helped you guys, and I will see you in the next video. Bye!